Parihar for giving us opportunity for this course. My topic is minimal training is a huge task. Actually, the objective of the medical support is to minimize the morbidity and mortality, both from the conventional and the CBRN threat. Second, it is to protect the medical personnel who are engaged in the management or from CBRN warfare agents while they are handling the casualties or working in the contaminated areas. Third is to conserve the fighting strength of the medical personnel. Fourth is to provide continuous medical care to the best possible extent. And fifth, and but not the least, is to avoid spread of the contamination into vehicles or other facilities. Training, as far as training is concerned, it starts from the preparation from the prevention of CBRN threat. It is a huge task. The CBRN threat, basically, we have to tell the individuals or the persons how to wear a individual protective equipment, because it is a massive equipment and requires training how to use it. Then use of collective protective shelters, which I will be showing in the subsequent slides, how to use it, how to erect them. Then food and water hygiene, how after wearing the individual protective equipment, how one can use them, eat food or urinate or defecate. These are important things which have to be learned. Nuclear threat, all the exposed body parts have to be covered. They are, and then the ears also, ear plugs have to be used. And the individual, every person should avoid looking at the fireball. They should use loose clothing and headgears also. Dark colored clothes or equipments, they absorb radiation and should be avoided. And for the biological threat, if the vaccination is available, should be given. Also, control measures for the vectors have to be done before the incident occurs. Second part is the early recognition of the threat. Once the threat has started, how can we recognize it? It is actually a very difficult task, and it, especially for the radiation, as Colonel Jaya told, it requires special equipment. Also, for the biological and the chemical threats, special kits are required to diagnose, to find out which agent is involved. As has been told, the especially the nuclear threat, first there is a intense radiation. Once the nuclear bomb is exploded or something, intense heat is produced, then shock and heat wave, then the fireball, it rises up, and then the mushroom clouds, they are produced. As far as the biological and the chemical threat is concerned, one should be suspicious of this type of threat if there is a low flying aircraft that is producing a lot of mist or spray. Also, functioning of any kind of spray device may give an indication that biological or chemical threat is in the progress. Also, bomblets that appear to have no immediate effect may lead to a chemical or biological threat. Also, they say insects suddenly arising in the atmosphere may be an indication of a biological threat. Then after this, another thing which is important is, once the CBRN attack or something has occurred, we have to inform the people in the affected area through mass media regarding the type and cause of threat, preventive measures which have to be taken, and the first aid measures which are essentially required. Otherwise, there will be a lot of confusion and panic. Coming to the protection from the CBRN agents, actually there are two types of protection. First is the individual protection. For this, special training is required, and the collective protection. Collective protection is basically to provide a contamination-free environment and to give relief from continuous wear of the individual protective equipment. As far as the individual protective equipment is concerned, it is a massive, costly equipment, which I don't think is available for mass, but it requires, it has three main parts. One is for detection of the warfare, second is the self-aid, and third is the decontamination kit. It consists of respirator, canister, and all those, which will be discussed by the successive speakers. Decontamination kit contains the fuller search, PDK 1 and 2, and besides these, we have the NBC suit, overboots, auto-injectors, dosimeter is also included in this. In addition, it contains the medical items, also form part of the individual protection kit, and water testing kit is also there. As far as the collective protection is there, we have something called as the decontamination chambers, or the are there. Their main aim is to remove or reduce the hazard caused by the CBRN and to decontaminate the skin, eyes, and wounds. And this can be done either by the physical means or the chemical neutralization or detoxification. Decontamination is mainly of three types. First is the for the self, that is the personal decontamination. Then of the casualties or the people who are affected by CBRN attack, that is the casualty decontamination. And the for the non-casualties, the personal decontamination. Decontamination is a huge task and requires dedicated staff, lot of resources, time, planning, training. All these things are required. As far as the simplest thing, what one can use is soap and water for decontamination. As far as the decontamination against the biological agents are concerned, it can be done by chemical or physical or mechanical decontamination. Chemical decontamination is the most effective, but it may damage the people or the materials. Physical means, one can use heat or UV radiation, and for mechanical decontamination, air filters or water can be used. These will be discussed later. However, the decontamination by the biological agents, one can use 0.5% sodium hypochlorite for skin, or for 5% hypochlorite solution for the clothing. Environmental decontamination is costly and difficult, usually done with, recommended with the formaldehyde. The most important part of this presentation is the emergency eating and drinking procedure. Once you are wearing the individual protection device, the equipment, then how to use, how to eat or drink when you have a, it is recommended only when essential, the eating or drinking should be done, because once you have to break the seal of the device, which is risky. Only food which is protected in tins and wrappings, which is resistant to penetration by the CBRN drug with the weapons, has to be used. For this, first you have to decontaminate the gloves, eating utensils, food container, and water bottles. Then you have to loosen the hood of the IPE device and steady your breath, hold your breath, lift the respirator away from the face, and then eat or drink in small quantities. Then after you have eaten or drank water, you have to replace the respirator and secure it. This is a very difficult, seems to be a difficult one, has to practice, and otherwise the total IP equipment is of no use. As far as the defecation and urination procedure is concerned, again, it is a huge task. First, you have to remove the waste belt, then release smoke waste Velcro fasteners. It has there. Decontaminate the gloves. Raise the smoke hem above the trouser waist. Untie the braces. Release trousers waistband. Pull the trousers down to the knees. Decontaminate gloves again and remove them. It has two parts, upper and outer and the lower inner. Then you have to store the gloves in the pocket. Adjust the inner clothing and defecate. And stand up, adjust inner clothing, decontaminate hands, replace gloves and adjust NBC clothing. These many steps are required to use if one is provided with the NBC, the protection equipment. This is a difficult task. One has to be taught. Otherwise, all the efforts will be of no use. So, the training in case of NBC, CBRN, warfare is a difficult task. We have to train and train for effective protection. Thank you so much.